On this video, we verify the following trig identity. We're going to be proving trig identities, and for the one on this video, you'll need to know these identities, the fundamental identities, and the Pythagorean identities, and you should know these well. Okay, we're going to try to verify this identity. I like to start on the more difficult side, and to me that looks definitely like the left-hand side. So I'm going to begin by writing everything in terms of sines and cosines. I like to start out that way. So I'm just going to work on the left-hand side. So cosecant of x is 1 over sine of x, and cotangent is cosine of x over sine of x. And in the denominator, we've got tangent of x, that's sine of x over cosine x, plus sine of x. Okay, so this is a complex fraction, so one way of dealing with complex fractions is you multiply the numerator of the whole fraction and the denominator of the whole fraction by the least common multiple of both denominators. So that would be cosine times sine. So I'm going to multiply this whole numerator and this whole denominator by cosine of x, sine of x. Again, you have to be good at your algebra. So I'm going to do the distributive property up here on the top. When I do 1 over sine x times cosine x sine x, do you see how the sines are going to cancel? And I just get a nice cosine x plus, and the sines cancel when I multiply by the second term, so I have cosine squared x. Right, now I have to do the denominator. When I multiply the sine cosine, sine over cosine times sine, let's see, the cosines cancel and I get sine squared x plus, and nothing cancels here because I had a 1 in the denominator, so I have a cosine x sine squared x. Well, let's see, does that look any better? Not yet. So what can I do? Well, how about we work on the other side and see what that ends up looking like. So if I put everything cotangent x, cosecant x into sines and cosines, I get cosine x over sine x times 1 over sine x. So I would get cosine x over sine squared x. So I'm kind of looking at both of them and seeing if I can, you know, finagle the two of them. How about if I factor out a cosine out of the numerator? What happens? Sorry. Cosine out of the numerator here. I have cosine of x times 1 plus cosine of x. And in the denominator, what if I had left that sine squared x? Factor that out, 1 plus cosine of x. Oh, cool. I see what's going to happen. Those cancel. And now notice, both sides, I get the same thing. Now what I could have done at this point is I see where this came from. I can rewrite this problem as cosine over sine times 1 over sine, and then go backwards, and it would end up looking like cotangent x cosecant x. But you basically showed by working on both sides. I'm sorry, it's kind of messy here on this small little tablet PC I'm working on, but you could see you get the same answer. So if you wanted to go down, what I was saying is at this point you could write this, seeing where, it's sort of like you kind of go back up, right? You could say, well, cosine x over sine squared x, I could write that as cosine x over sine x times 1 over sine x, and then cosine over sine is cotangent x, and 1 over sine is cosecant x. And now it's kind of a neat proof because I got it to look exactly like the other side. So see how the other side was cotangent x, cosecant x. And I could sort of erase this. Let everybody think I was just so clever. And that's a lot of times what mathematicians do. They kind of use that technique so that they could really do a more formal proof all the way down to the end here. And you're done. So that's where I could work on both sides, and I could see I got the same thing on both sides, or I could just work on one side till it looks exactly like the other side. So, wow, that was a tough one, but we were able to do it. I think it would be harder starting on the right-hand side and doing it. And again, there's different approaches. I just did this on the fly to see if I can get the answer. So let's just look at it one more time. I began by changing everything's to sines and cosines. And then I got rid of this complex fraction by multiplying the numerator and denominator by the least common denominator. Of course, you might do it a different way. Maybe you'll get a common denominator in the numerator and a common denominator in the denominator and multiply by the reciprocal. Still going to end up in the same place I ended up. And then, after I did that, at this step where I don't have a complex fraction, I factored and canceled. And then I'm keeping in mind, that's the trick, or you can't see it. But if you keep in mind where we're going here, let's see. So if you keep in mind where you're trying to end up, so let's say you have that. Somewhere, like right here, keep in mind where you're trying to go. It helps you. So you think, well, I'm trying to make it look like this. Okay. So you have to keep in mind where you're going to as you're working through the problem somewhere, which you can't see because I don't have a page long enough for you to see. All right. So we were able to get it to look like cotangent x. Cosecant x. Now, the trick is, could you do this all on your own? And if not, then go back through and copy what I've done. Write down what I'm doing at each step, even. In other words, explain. I'm factoring, I'm getting rid of the denominators, whatever, getting a common denominator, and just practice it. That's how you get good at these proofs. You take a tough proof and you just do the same proof 5 times in a row till it just becomes second nature. At least you have that one down. Okay.